Praise be to our triune God. It's been a huge pleasure for me to join the youth fellowship, because every time I've been back there in Dubai, I've always had this need, or I always wanted to attend one of the Bible studies, but unfortunately I couldn't do, because every time I come back home, it's just the 2 weeks holiday that I get. So I wasn't able to attend any of the meetings, but I feel honored, blessed, and covered by the grace of God that I am here with all of you today. Thanks a lot, Jason Ja, for calling me, and all the rest of the committee members. Thank you. So let's begin our Bible study. Let's begin with a word of prayer. Okay. Let's have a word of prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Master, thank you for this wonderful morning that you have given us. God, as we have gathered here for the Bible study, gracious God, we ask for thy presence throughout this meeting. As we meditate upon your word, be with us, guide us, protect us. Lord, you are the person who needs to talk with us. Though I talk, I need your presence. Be with all those who are hearing, and be with me also. All this and thy more we ask in thy holy and precious name. Amen. So before I start, the internet connections here in Kerala are not really great. So I might log out, but hold on, I will come back. So yeah. So can I just share the screen?
Yeah, you can share the screen, Jason.
Okay. Is it visible?
Yeah, Jeez.
Okay. So, fellowship with him, that is our topic today. I mean, the last Netflix film that I saw is the documentary by Sir David Attenborough, Life on a Planet. I am not sure how many of you have seen it, but if you haven't watched it, please go watch it. It is such an amazing documentary, I'll tell you, because the way it is taken, the way he raises a concern about how our biodiversity is, we are losing our biodiversity, there is nothing more, and the action has to be taken very instantly. A lot of things he talks. And the hard part is, all of this is shown right when we are going through a pandemic, right when we are staying at a home. Like, this was released when the time, most of the cities were under lockdown and we weren't able to come out. And there was this problem for a lot of people, like staying home, anxiety, depression, not able to socialize. And this movie apparently showed us we have this beautiful world that God has created for us. And how are we taking care of it? And as I told, there is this virus happening. And we look at this world, and an obvious question we would ask this world is, oh my God, why is this happening to this world? Like, this is such a beautiful world, but why do we have this virus and all the pandemic and people dying, a lot of people suffering because of the COVID-19? Why do you have to face all this? But then the next question that would arise is, there are a lot of people who are suffering. Okay, then let's all come together. In a sense, let's have a good fellowship with those who are suffering. Kind of like a support group. Now, all these fellowship or support groups are formed to meet a particular purpose. As we move forward, we have to understand that when we are formed for a particular purpose, our fellowship with God, where does it stand? Is it for a particular purpose? And have we attained that purpose? Think about it. Now, as we move forward, what is a fellowship meeting? Now, throughout this Bible study, I'll be using a lot the term fellowship, but let me tell you, I'm not referring to the youth fellowship meeting, but just the fellowship. Okay. Now, what is a fellowship meeting? since I always think of my college days, for me, a fellowship is always where there is a jamming session we come together, we sing Christian songs, we pray, we crack a lot of jokes, we have a dinner. There are a lot of friends around us. That's how a fellowship meeting grows. And later on, this develops into something that where we will have a Bible study that will also encourage us. Usually, that is how a fellowship meeting happens. So technically, the word fellowship means it includes a company of equals. There is a companionship happening there. There's a sense of harmony there because the people of like-minded thoughts coming in a single particular position, which is why the fellowship is always helpful. Now, it is important when we go back to the Old Testament, this particular incident for the Israelites, they were in Egypt and they happened and Moses was a leader and God happened to deliver them from Egypt to their promised land. Now, let's understand that in a point of fellowship. Now, the Israelites were staying together. Moses called them out with the help of God. Moses got them out. They are traveling. And the initial phase of the traveling is technically they are praising God. They are thanking God for all that God has been helping them for. But as it progresses, they reach the sea. They start questioning God. They start questioning Moses. They pass the sea phase. They go ahead. Again, they face this problem of food, water. All these crises comes. God delivers them, helps them. But again, they go on grumbling with God. Technically, what happened is they're losing out on their fellowship with God. Though they know that it is God who responding to the calls and cries throughout the journey, somewhere they're losing this entire hope, entire belief that it is God who saved them. They started grumbling against God. That's when God sent a serpent between them and a lot of people died. And God reinstates them by asking Moses to present before them the bronze serpent. So he is again bringing back the man and God fellowship. Now, the Old Testament ends there. The example of Old Testament ends there. Moving forward, we have the New Testament. We have Jesus reinstating our relationship with God. And going forward, we have this epistles. All the epistles, be it Peter, Paul, be it John, whoever writes it, they're always writing with the idea that man and God needs to get proper with God in terms of fellowship. Yes, Paul throughout his epistles are telling man and man should have a good fellowship. They should be having a good understanding. There's this small code of ethics between man and man. But they also keep on emphasizing the main factor that there should be fellowship with God. Now understand this. You have a chain that ends, that starts from one end and extends to the other end. Now, all the links of the chain is connected, but the use of the chain is not actually serving its purpose if one end of the chain is not attached to the other end of the pole. Even though all the links are connected, if it's not attached to the other end of the pole, the entire usage of a chain is actually useless. So we have to understand, we have fellowship with man. We have this company of equals, companionship with the creation. But if we don't have this fellowship with God, where are we standing? That's when the New Testament church, the church formed, churches began in small places and they started worshiping. They understood what Jesus has done and how his death on the cross has saved them and how they are waiting for his second coming, eternal life. That's how it progresses. Now, the epistle, third epistle comes in this particular context. Now, the author of the third epistle of John is said to be John, and there is no, there it is said to be John because a lot of similar factors in all these three epistles as well as the gospel are there. Things like the usage of the word truth, the name, elder of the world. I'll explain as we go forward, I'll explain what is truth, what is name. So John has this writing literary style of representing everything another word rather than the actual word. Say for truth, for elder, he, for instead of writing I, John, he uses elder. He has this another style of writing. Now it is believed to be written between 85 to 95 CE. And it is believed to be written to one of the seven churches in Asia Minor. Now, what are these seven churches? You read the book of the Revelations. If you read the first few chapters, you'll understand there are these seven churches where the letters has been written. So John is, so it is believed that this epistle was written to one of the house churches in Asia Minor. Now, where is Asia Minor? To put it into perspective, Asia Minor is the current Turkey. Right now, where the country of Turkey is, that's where the entire seven churches were. So understand, the Roman Empire extended all the way from, say, the present city of Italy, Greece, extended all the way to Turkey, then came down to Israel. So that was the Roman Empire. Now they were this under this huge persecution, and propagating Christian faith wasn't a great thing for them. It wasn't allowed for them in the first place, which is why John always, while writing his epistles, he made it a point to, like I was telling, the truth, the name, elder of the world, not. Now, as I told, these let John, while writing this particular epistle, is believed to be in Ephesus, which is also in Asia Minor. Now, the first, second, third letters of John is believed to be written to the churches. But there is a small catch in there. The first epistle is written to a church. When you look into the context of it, you understand that that is written to a church, addressing the problem, addressing what the church should be doing. In terms of while they are in this particular problem of different faith or different teaching is coming, how they are supposed to still hold on to it. Then the second epistle comes that is written to another church. But when you come to the third letter, it is very interesting. It is written to one of the house churches. Now, to put what house churches, to put it into simple perspective, let me do this. Dubai Marthoma Church, we have our Edavaga parish there. Then we have all these prayer groups. Now, these house churches as these prayer groups. So basically during this persecution, they had these house churches, and these house churches formed up the entire church. Now, John is writing this letter to Gaius, who is a member of this house church. Now, let's understand what this is. It's a single chapter letter. So let's just understand what all are its contents. The first verse is basically a salutation. From verse 2 to 8, it's basically commending Gaius. Then verse 9 to 10, it's rebuking Diotrephes. And verse 11 to 12, it's a comparison. Verse 13 to 14 is an exhortation and the final greetings. Before I advance further, let me just say that for this study, I was using the NRSV and the NIV Bible. So because I'm telling this because a lot of the other translations will have other words. I'll be using a lot of words here, and these translations will be having other words. If you find it pretty confusing, please note that if you have an NIV Bible or NRSV Bible, that would be more helpful for you. Okay. As we enter into it. And what is this fellowship? As I was telling, it is very much important, as much as man is having fellowship amongst, or humans are having fellowship amongst themselves, it is important that there should be fellowship with God. Now, this particular letter tells how much it is of an importance that they should be. While this letter is referring to two people there, or two or three people there, it's also pointing out to the fact that how this church, this community, should be having a relationship with God also. Now, as we move forward, I'll be dividing this into two portions, from 2 to 8 and from 9, verses 2 to 8 and from 9 to 12. And each will be divided into particular portions, two different topics, and each of the topics will be handling with a fellowship with man as well as fellowship with God. Now, the first part, action. Now, as we move forward, verse 3 to 5, you understand that Verse 3, it says like this: "It gave me a great joy when some believers came and testified about your faithfulness to the truth, telling how you continue to walk in it. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth. Dear friend, you are faithful in what you are doing for the brothers and sisters, even though they are strangers to you." Now, one of the key words that is being used here is faithfulness. Faithfulness to the truth. As I said earlier, truth is basically, by the usage of word truth, John is the only meaning that John is giving to it is the truth that Jesus Christ came. The gospel, that's the truth that John is referring to this particular sentence here. Now, he is commending them or encouraging them or thanking them for the very fact they are still in this truth. They are faithful to the truth. As I told you, this time they had a lot of problems. So for a starters, we can say they had this persecution going on. Then next to that, they also had this Gnostic teaching. The reason that a lot of people understood or thought that that was the right teaching, and they left from the Christian faith and they moved on to the Gnostic teaching. So the author is telling, I'm so happy you are still in faithful to the truth, not moving from it, but you are still continuing on it. So what is this we have to understand from this? The topic is action. There is this kind of action that we have to build in ourselves that should rise and stay within us, which is faithfulness. If you go back into the Gospel of Matthew, Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 25, all the parables there is concerning to the second coming. And it ends with Jesus Christ telling them, all who are staying faithful will be saved. Now, all that parable is just telling them, you know what, all these tough times are going to come, but still, are you going to be faithful? Now, trust me, we live in a very difficult time. I've got people asking me, what is this even, is this faith even true? Because we see a lot of issues right now and we see God not working. So is this even true? Now that's where our faithfulness to God, the gospel, to the belief, to the faith and the hope that we have should be more solid, which is why I'm telling the purpose of being faithful in this truth stands more clear and stands of more importance right now. Now, this first point was actually the fellowship with God. Now, the action part also deals with the fellowship with man. Hospitality. When we read from verse 6 to 8, they say, they have told the church about your love. Please send them on their way in a manner that honors God. It was for the sake of name that they went out, receiving no help from the pagans. We ought therefore to show hospitality to such people so that they may work together for the truth. Now, there are these three things that is very, very evident in these verses. One is the love. Then what kind of hospitality we should show? The manner that honors God. The next one is, when we show hospitality, we together are working in it. So who are these strangers that John is speaking about? So there are these missionaries who visit the churches, and John is sending this letter with them. And John is also telling them, you know what, I have had these missionaries come back to me and tell me that you guys have been really good. And the hospitality you guys have been showing is out of love. And it is that honors God. Now, the usage of the phrase, the name, the sake of the name, is also used in John 15, 21. It actually means Jesus Christ or God. As I told you, he is using these other words for this particular term. Now, go back to the epistles. The references are here. Acts 28:7, Romans 12:13, 16:23, 1 Titus 5:12, 1 Peter 4:9. All of these verses actually speaks to us about how our hospitality engages both men and all those men engaged in spreading the gospel. And the question that we have to ask ourselves is the hospitality that nowadays we are showing with our with the creation, is it out of formality? When I was reading this book by Max Lucado, it's a beautiful book by Max Lucado, On the Anvil, here's this term that he used, complacency to God. So complacency is basically, you know that you think that you're self-sufficient, but when you know that there is a huge deficiency going on, but you still feel that you're self-sufficient. That's the kind of complacency that we have. Our hospitality based on this? Are our fellowship lost on based on this formality? Now, the thing with this is, if you read Romans 12:13, he says, Paul talks about mutual action. He tells that there should be a mutual action between the members. Now, let me say this. A person, a family, a couple decides to go on an anniversary date. So now what happens? Decides to book up a place, calls up a restaurant and tells that we need a table for two on a particular date. So you go there, and you tell them also this is your anniversary, so you are expecting something great, like some kind of freebies also there. Now you go there, they provide you with your menu, you order, you have your dinner, you have this candlelight setup and all. It's amazing. And it's stopped by, at the end, mostly this happens, I have seen this mostly while I was in Bangalore. It stopped with this, they give you this cake written with happy anniversary and lighting candles and all. It's really good. Now what happens is, you find this really good. Go back to your office, you tell your colleague, your friend, now you know what, we went for an anniversary dinner, it was just amazing that those people, right, they were so considerate and it is actually good of them that they were thoughtful that they arranged all this. And that is word of mouth, right? Now, hospitality involves this word of mouth. The better you are in your hospitality, there is a fellowship that is building. Which is why Romans 12:13 is talking about this particular mutual action. Paul is trying to talk about this very fact that there should be a mutual action within its members. A faith accompanied. Why is it even there? Now, faithfulness to truth and hospitality, according to this passage, it tells us something very important. It is an accomplished fact and is already done. The result out of it is already done, but it is also our duty that we have to go ahead and do it. I guess you got it. The result out of this faithfulness and the hospitality is already there, but it's also up to us to go ahead and do this. Otherwise, what happens is it ends up just as a formality. Let's move forward. Verses 9 to 12. I've seen this as a responsibility. Now, with a fellowship with God, verse 11, dear friend, do not imitate what is evil. Anyone who does what is good is from God. Anyone who does what is evil has not seen God. Now, he talks about a person called Diotrephes here, and he says this person in this church, in your church, he is a person who loves to be first, and he talks malicious nonsense. And he is a person who refuses to welcome. So basically, we can term it under his selfishness and arrogance. Now, this person is not a good factor to imitate. Now, 1 Corinthians 4:16, 11:1, 1 Thessalonians 1:6, 2:14, 2 Thessalonians, all these epistles, Paul is trying to say that we should imitate Christ. Now, this is our responsibility. when you are being, or when we are being in fellowship with him, it is our responsibility that we should try and imitate him. I use this word try and imitate him because in one of the verses that Paul was referring, he was telling, I guess it's 1 Corinthians 11:1, he is trying to say, by imitating, you are also imitating his suffering. And with that suffering, we are becoming close to him, which means in this imitation, there is this binding that is happening. A good example is if you have a good group of friends and you always see this particular good behavior from this person, you try to imitate it because you find that is good. And that is also a sense of binding for you into that particular group or to that friendship. Now, we have to check ourselves. Are my actions worthy of imitation for others? Because all our actions serve as testimonies. Which brings us to the next portion with our fellowship with humans, men, creation. Testimony. The Greek word for testimony is martyria. Now, martyria is taken from another Greek word, martyr, which means, understand, you know, I guess you know what martyr is. Now, that is witness. Witness who believes that one thing is true. Now, our testimony, how do we hold on to this testimony? A good example is, I've seen this thing happening because while even I was working, I find this happening. When you have a job opening in your office, there is something called referrals. All of you know this. So when this referral opens, you send out messages, Instagram stories, Facebook posts, WhatsApp status to on your feed and telling them, hey, there's a job opening in this place. Your payment will be so and so or negotiable. DM me. That's what you do. Now, once one of your friend comes up and have this position, can you refer me? And there comes another job for you that you have to write a testimony for this person, proving for the company, for the organization that you know this person and this person is really good. And we end up giving far obvious testimony. You might know 5% of that person, but what you write on that testimonial shows that you know 90% of that person. That's how we end up writing because these referrals are also based on incentives. But here, this testimony, because it's testimony, if we read through verse, let me go back. Yeah, if we read through verse 12, there is this, Demetrius is well spoken of by everyone and even by the truth itself. We also speak well of him and you know that our testimony is true. Now, Diotrephes is being compared or is shown in comparison with another person called Demetrius. Now, he is being testified by 3 people. So, the author says, everyone who comes to me is telling about Demetrius. Amazing. The truth itself, so his action, his life, speaks a volume of him. The truth, he stays intact with the gospel and with all of us. So the author is referring him and all those who are with him. So there are 3 people referring this person, Demetrius, and telling this guy is an. Now, my point is, how much are we testifying God for all that we have, all that he has given us, or for all that he has done for us? Now, this will be based on mutual love. Verse 1 to 8. Paul is also telling about this mutual love. And he also tells that we are joining the suffering for the gospel, not to be ashamed. Now, even if you are being ashamed and still joining, being part of that suffering in this gospel, then there is this mutual love that is happening. So we should have a responsibility in order to be in fellowship with him, that there should be a testimony from our side that he is the only one. Our life should be showing that. Now, let's conclude this. Our fellowship with him, as we in the beginning discussed, is it based on faithfulness to, by being faithfulness to the truth? With all that is happening in our life right now, the anxiety, the depression, the lot of issues that is going on with us. I've had people asking, coming and talking to me about anxiety attacks. I mean, that was first for me, but then anxiety attacks, I understood, are really a big, huge problem right now. Not just for them, but for all of us right now, is our faith growing cold? Are we losing the fire within us? Are we losing the faithfulness to the truth? The second thing is our hospitality being very formal? Are we doing this just because we have to do this? As I told, this is faith accomplished. It is already done. But then, are we out of the love for building a relationship or just for formality? Next thing is, as I told about the responsibility, imitating. Does our imitation bind me, my fellow beings, my colleagues with God? Is it even binding it? Another question that we have to ask ourselves, every testimonials that we see, is it based on a mutual love? Is there a give and take there? Or is it just because I'm doing this because I need some gain out of this? Is it just because of me or just also because of others? Because that I care for this person that I'm testifying. And last of all, we have to understand with this epistle, where do we stand? Are we being Diotrephes or are we being Demetrius? Diotrephes is a person who loves to be first, who refuses to welcome, and who goes on talking malicious nonsense. And Demetrius here is another person who is being testified by the entire church, the entire region, and all the missionaries who come to the church, who go back, reports to the author that this person is amazing. Where do we stand? All these are questions that we have to ask ourselves despite this pandemic period or anything, all the problems, issues, personal life issues that we are going through. We have to ask ourselves this. Despite this praying, I always feel this void. Am I growing cold in my faith? Am I losing out something? This is a problem that everyone faces. Just as the Israelites, even though they knew that it was God who took them out of every places and made them move forward, they have this problem of questioning themselves, where is God? When time and problem comes, they ask this question, where is God? And this is kind of question that comes to us also. During those times, we have to understand and ask ourselves, are we having fellowship with him or are we having fellowship with humans only? Are we having fellowship just with our friends? Or are we actually having fellowship with him? We have to understand this. This is an amazing verse I really love. 1 Corinthians 6:20. For you were brought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body. This purely shows the reason for why we should have a fellowship with God. We are brought with a price. And with this price, yes, obviously, we are supposed to gather a lot of people through our works, through our testimony, through our imitations, through our hospitality. But above all, it is also meant to glorify God. And glorifying God means that it completes, glorifying God completes in our body when we are in fellowship with him. May God bless and guide us by these words. Amen.